I'm Sanjay Mittal. I've started as an AI researcher at Xerox PARC long time back, and the last 25 years I've been doing startups, companies doing internet-based sales and pricing and configuration, marketing automation, those kinds of things. So I'm happy to share my experience along the way. We have a very interesting panel who have done all kinds of different things from gentleman on my right has probably more leadership experience than I think the whole room put together. He's probably done 4 careers work. So Venk Shukla, we have Gaurav who's at Google and I think can share some interesting perspective from big, not so startup, but a big company that seems to do innovative stuff all the time. And then we have Nimish. So Venk, say something about yourself.
Hi, my name is Venk Shukla and I started my career in India in civil service and then came here and worked in design automation industry for a while and my claim to fame there was that I think among all the people I was one of the first Indians to rise up through sales and marketing to a VP of a Fortune 500 company. So that was my claim to fame, but I'm dating myself in the process. And after that, I've been involved with about 50 startups as an entrepreneur, as a CEO or as a board member, as an advisor, or lately as an investor. So that's my experience. And other thing that's relevant to this conference is that I used to be president of TiE.
Gaurav.
Hello, everyone. My name is Gaurav Kataria. I run a machine learning team in Google. I've been at Google for 6 years, and machine learning is a hot field. I spoke about it yesterday as well. And what I would like to share with you today in this conversation is, as you are working in a new area and trying to develop teams in a new area, the war for talent is really, really high, and it becomes extremely challenging to come up and to develop as a leader to retain, attract, and grow the talent. And that's one thing that I've been able to learn in the last few years at Google, and I'd be happy to share with you.
Hi, folks. My name is Nimish Mehta. I've also been in the Valley for quite a long time, a technologist or engineer by training, like a lot of you folks, I'm sure, are from IIT Delhi. And then I came here to do my master's. I ended up working for Bell Labs and then Oracle, where I was a senior VP, reporting directly to Larry Ellison. And then I did 2 startups, and if you have time, we can talk about them. Both were venture funded. After that, I was at Siebel, SAP, and now I've been running my own data strategy consulting firm for about 9 years, going very well. So that's my background. Big company, small company, both of them.
So the theme of the session is about leadership. You know, what are the issues that come up in trying to build a company, lead it through tough times, build the teams, motivate the employees, raise money, the go-to-market vision, any and all of those kinds of things. So any of those topics are, I think, germane topics for you guys to ask questions, have a dialogue.
Let me just say something about what I've learned to say about leadership through my career. One of the key discoveries along the way for me was that people who join your team don't join your team, to make you rich, to make you successful, or to make your ego get bigger. They join for their own reasons. And so long as you understand what their reasons are, what their motivations are, and so long as they find it worthwhile that their goals would be realized in your team, they'll stay with your team. I mean, Silicon Valley, as I said, is extremely competitive market for talent, and the talent will stay with you so long as they think that their goals are being realized by being is part of your team. So that's intellectually it's a sort of kind of easy to understand, but to understand it in your gut and to modify your behavior to make that happen, is that's where the real essence of leadership is.
lot of people think that since you work at Google, it must be very easy for you to attract talent.
Yes.
It's a well-known company. You get lots of resumes, and you can just pick one out of 1,000, and your job is done. Unfortunately, it's not as simple as that. Yes, you have 1,000 resumes, but it's not as simple as pick any one out of the 1,000. And not only that, there is competition for talent even within Google. So if I want to attract some good engineers to my team, there are other products at Google, other teams at Google that are also competing to get the same best engineers, the same best product managers. So it's never easy. I mean, even when you think like you are working at a great company that has a lot of reputation and everyone will come to you, or you are a hot startup and everyone will apply and want to join you because you're pre-IPO, even then you would have to compete for talent. And even within a company, you will have to compete for talent, for your group. Now, of course, I want good for all of Google, and I want talent to be there in all parts of Google. But when you're building a team that's really a great team, you want to make sure that every member of the team is great, and the sum of the parts is greater than the each part together. I mean, individually put together. So that's the kind of focus that I have tried to put in my team, and I'll be happy to share more.
My name is Raj Shah. I just founded a company called Percipient.ai. We are going to specialize in computer vision and AI focused on the defense market. Now, when you talk about leadership, you sort of tend to fall into talking about leadership of the CEO in a startup. Most of us are, we have co-founders, and we'll have other leaders in the company. So what is your, what perspective can you give us in terms of when you think about leadership for multiple people in the company, and what should you watch out for so that the leadership qualities are not conflicting with each other, but are complementary?
Nimish?
Yeah, so that's a good one. So the current company that I run, I have a co-founder. Actually, all of the companies I've run, I've had co-founders, obviously. And the alignment of your co-founder and your leadership team, not just the co-founder, is really, really important for several. I mean, it's important all, you know, it's important when I was at Oracle, at SAP, and stuff like this. But in the larger firms, the one thing is that no one individual is that important at the end of the day. And, you know, if you lose somebody, you can sort of make it work. If you have a smaller organization and you lose one of the key people or they're not aligned with your interests, it can be absolutely devastating. The flip side is that if you have the leadership team aligned, it can be incredibly motivating to the rest of the organization to see that. So the simplest thing that I have found, you know, in doing this is to be with the leadership team, but also everyone, but certainly leadership team, be extremely transparent and straight about what is happening and what's not happening. So, for example, we be transparent about things like, you know, the situation of the company with regard to cash position or sales or, you know, product development, good or bad or ugly. And I find that if you do that, that's one. The second is to be as, it sounds kind of weird, but as humble or as down to earth as you possibly can. Just because I find that as the CEO, and I mean, certainly true for others, you know, there's an inherent sort of this quote level thing that gets built up, whether you like it or not. It just happens. And I try very hard to remove it. Because if you actually make it so everyone feels like they're equal, and they know what's going on, and we talk frequently, they will communicate the values, and they will help us define the values together correctly. And it becomes a shared journey. It's their journey as much as it's mine, and that means they share the burdens, and in the good, bad, and ugly times, and there are many, many difficult times, and they help you with that. So my thing is be extremely transparent, so they know exactly what is going on. They we be very sort of straight about, you know, all of the challenges, and then also be humble and share. And one way to be humble or to be personable is to share personal stories, right? So if something happened at home with your kids or whatever, then share that. It's fine. I mean, people see you as a human being. They don't see you as some sort of a, you know, person with a title. And so I find those things help build that camaraderie, and it helps build, unifies the team, and then helps build leadership that way.
So Raj, I think one of the things that is an issue in the early stage of the company is how do you divide the founder equity, Because if you do it the wrong way, then you'll have two or three founders where one person feels that they somehow got shafted and their interests become misaligned, and people like that end up becoming troublemakers. So the question is, what is fair? I think as long as the criteria by which it's been decided, whether it is one-third, one-third for three founders or, you know, 40-40-20, it should be defensible in terms of what they bring to the table, the money, the technology, the experience, the ability to raise more money. As long as those criteria are clear and can be articulated and people can buy in, then I think a founding team where they are comfortable with it and their interests are aligned. I think that ends up, and I've seen cases where they've done the wrong way and it creates so much bad blood that companies ultimately don't succeed.
So I want to add something to that. This whole cap table issue, that is an interesting one, and we talked about it a little before this. So one thing is the founder equity issue, right? And I know we're also not just talking about startups here, but for a minute, let's talk about how you divide the equity. Between founders, I personally have had this position that it should be equal. There is no rule that says. I see many companies in which, you know, the CEO has 60% and the other guys have 30-40. I mean, there's nothing inherently wrong with it. But it just feels weird because you start a company and you're on this long journey, which is difficult, with these other people, and you know there is really no good reason why you should have unequal equity with your founders. That's at least a very personal view. It's not necessarily the case for everybody, but there's a larger issue of equity for all of your employees and certainly key employees. So the one thing I've always held fast is, if that cap table were, that ownership table were to be made public, and it may not ever be public, right? But if it were to be made public, with people looking at that cap table, your employees, say, that was grossly unfair, or was that reasonable? You know, everyone thinks they're worth a king's ransom, I get that, but when you take that away, you know, is it reasonable? And if it's reasonable and the equity share is split reasonably, whether you get 1% or 10%, people are generally okay with it. So this is back to the fairness thing. So that is the one thing I've always held is, what would other people say if they knew? You know, and like I said, they rarely know, but that's not the point, right? It's, you have to live with it yourself, so.
Oh, hi, I'm Sunil Ravipadi. Good evening, panelists. I'm Oracle alumni, like Nimish. Nice to see you, Nimish, here. So I have a question regarding, you know, entrepreneur who starts off just by himself or herself and then grows into a leader, or an individual contributor at a large company who grows into a leader. So what are some of the key attributes you can share, how an individual contributor or an entrepreneur who starts off as an individual person can grow into a leadership to the next milestone, going to the next milestone, leading a team or stepping into the shoes of leadership role? What are the key attributes and any success stories or any personal stories you can share that will also be helpful?
So I think there's definitely a journey from being an individual contributor to being a team leader. But then there is also a journey after you become a team leader and you kind of grow further, after becoming a team leader as you grow further. And kind of my main observation in that journey has been that it is the productivity and the effectiveness of the entire team you build. And one thing I learned sort of in an academic fashion about building good teams is teams go through their own journey and their life. And as the team leader, as someone who's shepherding that process, you have to understand that process. And it has four stages. So the first stage is kind of you're forming a team. That's formation. The second stage is storming. Like, you put smart people together, they're not going to agree. They're going to storm. They're going to disagree with each other. There'll be fights, and you'll have to, as a team leader, you'll have to manage all of that. Then the third stage is norming, where kind of the heat is off, and then people are kind of settling down, and sort of they're starting to do their work. And then finally, you have the stage of performing, where, okay, everybody is actually performing at their capacity. And what you can do as a leader is you can't skip any stage. I mean, pretty much every team has to go through all four stages. You can just speed it up so that you get to performing stage quickly, so that the team can start performing and show results. And that is how, I mean, if the team does good and the good work comes out, as a leader, you will definitely be benefiting from your team's output and benefit productivity. So my main take is that as you are managing a team or you're managing multiple teams, make sure that in each team you are speeding up this process of kind of forming, storming, norming, and performing. And if you can speed it up, then you've done your magic. And if you get stuck, either at forming or storming or norming stage, then you will never hit performing, and then if you never hit there, there'll never be any performing stage and never a good outcome.
Hi, I'm Arvind. I'm Arvind Lalam. The firm I have, we started last year in San Diego. I flew in here for this session. And what I'm really looking forward to in the talk, some of which I already got, by the way, thank you for your insights, is for a company that's growing at various stages, there are different challenges, right? At the forming, it's the co-founder, the stakes. And when you're forming the core team, you know, how do you build the ratios such that somebody coming in later fits in, you know, and nobody feels like they're getting the tough end of the bargain. Later on, the challenges keep moving. And I'm really interested in the first stages, starting with when, as I recruit my team, and they're from various parts of the country, one thing I noticed is, most of the times it is the appeal for startup, the uptake, you know, that's been a great motivator, and they're convinced of the idea, they're in. But it seems like for bringing somebody from Bay Area into the team takes little more than that. Mm. And I'm curious if you can portray a picture of a profile of somebody who could join a team. What are they looking for, right? And what excites them?
So it's interesting when you, as a leader or the founder, I think we have a special response. I mean, anyone who leads any team has a responsibility. But I think as founders of startups, we have a bigger responsibility because we are asking people to take a lot more risk. Their paycheck may not be guaranteed. They may have to take a pay cut in the beginning. 6 months from now, you may run out of money and you may have to ask them to leave. So you also have to make sure that the people who are joining you have that risk appetite. And so, for example, I was trying to hire someone in Pune for my company. I mean, he'd worked with me before. And he said, look, I just got married, and I can't convince my wife that I can join this no-name company, which obviously no one knows about in Pune. So I said, that's fair, and I would not twist around to join me. I mean, he could have joined me. So, I mean, partly you have to motivate people, but partly you have to filter out people who may not have the right risk profile for being on this journey with you.
You know, a lot of it is self-selection. And self-selection is based on do people buy, especially for a startup, self-selection is based on do they really buy into that vision? Do they buy into your leadership? Do they have faith in the leadership? And finally, do they have a belief that whatever goals they have in life, this would be a stepping stone to those things? And finally, all these things. And then it comes down to compensation. But each situation is very unique. I don't think there is a recipe for this thing. I've been in a number of different situations where in one case it was very easy to recruit because the company startup was was riding the hype and everybody wanted to be part of that kind of a thing. And the other one was where you're going against the current and it's very, very difficult to convince people that the rest of the world is wrong, but we are right.
Good afternoon. My name is Aluri Raju. I'm a co-founder for Sales Canary. It's an AI-based solution for B2B sales. I have a question. So as co-founders, we started, bootstrapped it, and we're fairly managing it. When it comes to teams, we found it better to outsource a lot of the engineering development outside. And we don't want to, it doesn't make sense for us to take the overhead of hiring and so on. So as in a startup life, at what stage does it become important to build that team in the organization instead of just taking the outsourced skill and manage the business?
I think that's a good question because obviously there is all kinds of OPD organizations available that you can outsource. I think the key thing is, do you need to own that IP? I mean, what is your value add? If your value add is IP, then you better own it. If your value add is that you know how to go to market or you're building some...
Otherwise, you won't be able to sell the company.
Yeah.
If you don't own the IP, or if the IP or IP development is outsourced, when it comes down to selling the company, people will discount that very severely.
Right, exactly.
Because unless you have some magical way of generating revenue that doesn't need the product, end of the day, someone is going to buy you, say, okay, how do I keep this IP going? Software never, the only time software dies is when no one is using it. Otherwise, it's always a living thing. You have to keep on improving it, modifying it, and so on. So who are the engineers behind that? If they're not your employees, what is someone buying?
So there's one other thing I want to add to that, because I've actually had experience doing both. And a lot of my good friends work in these OPD companies, and they're great firms, by the way. But the thing I found is there's a couple of things. One is it's not cheaper in the long run. And people talk about turnover. I'm not talking about that. If you look at it, it's just the hourly rates, right? I mean, it's okay if you need one or two people, it's probably just easier just to get them from an outsourcing firm, because you're three people or four people at the company. I mean, you're not going to go set up an India unit and all the rest of it, right? So that makes sense. But the moment you get to anything of reasonable size, four, five, six people, you do the math, it doesn't seem to work out, because those guys have to make some money too. So you'll find it's roughly equal. That's point one. Second is, what I found is there's less commitment to keeping that same unit together when you go to an outsourcing firm. Because I've looked at what those employees are being told. So if you join like a great firm is persistent. Great firm, by the way. Really good work. What you find, they tell their employees, I was curious, what do they tell? What they say is this: look, you join this firm, you'll work on different products with different companies, you'll have the excitement of a startup, but we'll also take care of you from a career point of view. From time to time, we'll move you from company to company so you can develop your career. This is wonderful for the employee, but it's not so great for you, because you lose that talent because they move these employees. So you find these guys stick around for a year, year and a half on your project, then they're moved. So issue number one is actually not cheaper. The math hasn't worked as far as I'm concerned, beyond one or two people, right? Second thing is you have this turnover thing going on, right? Or people leaving the firm. So when you put it all together, it's just not worth it. The other thing is, of course, the other issue which we can talk about if needed is teams here versus teams in India, that whole thing, right? There's a whole dimension to it as well. But
hi, I'm Arthur Larasu from Lucky Bug Group. We have offices in four countries and we have multiple businesses. We have recently came to Silicon Valley. So my question is, how do you identify a performing person and a not performing person, and not lose your time in Silicon Valley, where you find somebody can do investment, somebody can say, I do sale, I can do strategic partnership, all blah, blah, blah. And how do you not waste time and actually find somebody who can be more results oriented?
So you're saying this is a problem with people you're looking for in Silicon Valley or in general?
I came here for the past 2 months. I engage with several people in different meetups and stuff. I find a lot of weed, and I find the actual results-oriented people to be not much, so I'm just concerned, yeah.
It's a very, very frequent problem. And people you see who are outside, you see when they say, okay, I'll hire a salesperson here. They either hire a recruiter or they talk to someone. And good salespeople are very good at selling themselves. But they're not necessarily good at selling what you want them to sell. And somehow, you see, you learn through experience that, you can't rely on that thing. But there's no shortcut to that, unfortunately. The only way to do that is if you have a network of advisors here or network of people who care about you and in that domain, and they give a referral to you. I mean, if you are hiring the first person, you better invest that kind of thing in building relationships here, so that they can point the right guy to you. Otherwise, one bad hire, and the problem with sales guys is that you won't discover for 9 to 12 months that this guy is bad.
Your friend in that process is LinkedIn, by the way.
No, it is not just the sales. I mean, it could be fundraising, investment, or a strategic partnership. It's across a different pipeline. We have 100 people in our office. We have mobile threat assessment, risk assessment, and we have customers. And we know this is the market where we have to take a lot of customers and stuff. I cannot lose a lot of time finding people, engage them, lose three months, 6 months, then, I lose only time. I don't do anything here.
No, we'll be offering a survey that you'll say doesn't work, so I would rather not offer it.
Hi, my name is Krishna, and I run a company called Agile Entrepreneurs. We are a network of successful bootstrapping entrepreneurs, ranging from a few hundred thousand in revenue to 100 million in valuation. without who built companies without any VC funding. Maybe he should talk to us. But the question is, there is a gap, and it's a healthy, reasonable gap, but entrepreneurs don't know this, and I wish more investors would tell them upfront about this. The Venn diagram, the intersection between what VCs want or investors want and what entrepreneurs want, it's a very small intersection. Mm-hmm. And that is ideal only when entrepreneurs have user engagement, customer traction, and a little bit of sign of growth. And to get there on their own, the best way is not to quit their job and a year or two later struggling to get 50,000 when they could have, in lost wages, they would have 2 years later, 250,000, right? So your thoughts on this, and you know, how many entrepreneurs do you tell this, and maybe you can talk to this about how you bootstrap all the way until you get funding.
So I think you seem to be asking at least two very different questions, maybe three, and I'm sure that
probably.
So the three different questions is, one is, do you want to do a company that needs venture funding, or can you do the company without venture funding? I think that's one issue. The second is, what makes you believe that, you know, it's worth leaving your job to go do a company in the first place, right? To me, that's a very different issue. So let me start with the second question. I think you need to find your own way of validating the business problem that you're trying to solve. But I'll give you my experience. I mean, when I was at Xerox PARC, I'd been doing work in this whole area of trying to, you know, automatically configure product from a sales perspective, and I said, okay, you know, I want to do a startup. So the first thing I did is actually hired a market research firm and gave them a list of 50 companies that are potential customers, you know, companies that build complex equipment, and gave them a whole questionnaire to see, is there a real problem? And most companies could not identify the problem the way I defined it, but when you get deeper into it, it was very clear they all had the same problem, and it was a serious problem. So that is the grounding that I think allowed me personally to say, okay, I'm going to do this for the next 2-3 years without funding, without anything, because the need is there. So I think as an entrepreneur, you need to have that kind of a grounding that the problem is real and you are bringing something special to that problem. If you're just getting enamored, you know, I'm going to do a startup because someone just sold one for $4 billion and I want to have that, I think that's the wrong basis to go do a startup.
Just to be clear, that's exactly what we do. We teach entrepreneurs, we coach them to do that. Like the four segments we call strength, passion, wisdom, and stamina. Stamina to survive long enough, you know, like that story of the mad scientist and the horse he was trying to feed less and less each day until one day it dies. He was hoping to, you know, teach the horse to live without food. And when it dies, he exclaims, just when it learned how to live without food, it died. And that's the story of a lot of bootstrapping entrepreneurs.
And you know, if you look at Silicon Valley, there are a lot of companies that have had near-death experience. Yeah. And some of them went on to become big companies. I'll give you one example, Cisco. There was a time in the 80s where Cisco was being shopped around to quote-unquote other bigger networking companies, because who wants to build, you know, keep investing in this router thing which is sort of on the fringes of the network? Hubs were the big thing, and no hub company wanted to buy Cisco. And Cisco went on to become a big company, and all the hub companies died. Now, there are a lot of counter stories to that where companies didn't survive, and you know, you could attribute it to luck, or you could attribute it to the persistence of the successful entrepreneur.
The last thing I want to say quickly is, our definition of failure in our group is you end up with a lifestyle business. That's it. So we don't accept the fact that an entrepreneur has to end up divorced, bankrupt, and career ruined. You can actually turn that into a healthy lifestyle business. If you can show up to a job and be mildly productive and get 10, 20,000 a month, you can surely turn that into a startup which can make you 10, 15,000 a month.
Yeah, actually, that's exactly what I was going to say. I don't even consider that a failure. I'll tell you why.
No,
I'm saying it.
I'm being facetious.
I know. So this whole thing about venture funding and entrepreneur alignment, I think it's a really, really insightful point, which is, I believe that when you first raise capital with the first round, that the alignment is very strong between the venture capitalists and the entrepreneurs. But I think over time, it could potentially diverge. And it's an interesting problem, because most of the times, it depends, every case varies, but a lot of VCs want to put a lot of capital to work, because if you look at all the VC funds, right, they all have, you know, the big ones, they all have, you know, half a billion, a billion under management. You can't put so much money to work unless you're putting 20, 30, 40 million in a company, right? Because otherwise, how are you going to find a lot and lot of startups that are all half a million investments? That doesn't work. So their whole sort of incentive is to put a lot of money to work because they get the 2% management fee and then the 20% on the, you know, on the gains, right? So now from as an entrepreneur, that's interesting, but it may not actually align with what you find to be your personal goal. So you think about it, right? A lot of people will say, I don't want a boss. I don't like working in a large company. I don't like the bureaucracy. I don't like the politics. I don't like this nonsense, right? And so a startup is really good for you. However, you end up with a VC on your board who's a jerk, pardon my French, and you basically just went from bad to worse because you went from a large company where you have a lot of safety, you know what I mean, at the end of the day, to a startup where the guy will fire you in about 3 seconds. And so it's not necessarily a good thing. It'll make you, you know, it could be a really rough ride or it could be a fantastic ride if your startup's going well. So the thing I sort of asked myself is, for this one that I'm running, this is a bootstrap. We own it. Me and my co-founder own it with some of all the employees. It is a consulting firm, so it's much, much easier to do, but it's not a body shop. We do strategy consulting in corporate strategy and data strategy. And it's been 9 years. It's been fabulous. It's been absolutely fabulous. Do I have an exit plan? No, I don't know, and I don't really care. Because it's very good. It's profitable. We have a lot of stress, but the stress is all caused from things like, how will we grow the business next year and stuff? No, there's no boss on my head telling me what to do. And I personally like that. You call it a lifestyle business, fine, call it a lifestyle business. A lot of people ask me, why didn't you do another product company? Because I don't want to deal with another board and another sort of board presentation. And the VCs that come every month, they sprinkle advice on you. Then they kind of go away, right? And they've never run a company in their life, right? So they don't know what they're doing. Then you have to go like, chase that down. I just don't want to do it. So if it's different for different people. Obviously, there's a ton of people here you hear that have done fantastically well with venture funding and have amazing success. So I'm not saying this is the best way, but I think lifestyle businesses are undervalued in Silicon Valley. So venture capital is glorified. And raising capital is generally celebrated. And I think you should not be celebrating it necessarily because it may or may not be a good thing for you. It depends.
Thank you.
I'm Raj from Blue Green Networks. We are into social fundraising. The question I have for the panel is, typically we are in Silicon Valley, we are tech founders. So now we have bootstrapped ourselves just to give a background. I think many would have done similar. We have not taken any VC funding, but for the first 1,000 customers, which we need to acquire, we are not a business savvy, but we are willing to do whatever is needed. So what would you advise each one from your perspective? How can we take the role of tech founder to a business founder? So that way we can acquire the customers so that we can show the traction and take it to the next step for the VC funding in the future.
So I'm not sure I understand the question.
The question is, you're a tech. Always you wear the tech mindset when you engage the customer, but you need to take a step back and be a business founder when you are engaging the customers. What would you advise from your past experience? Well, one thing, so the tech founder can take the tech hat and be a business guy.
So I think there's a presumption in what you said, which I want to quibble with, which is, you know, when you start a company, you're not a tech founder, you're a businessman. Because you're starting the company not as a research project someplace, you're starting a company to sell some product or service to someone else who's solving their problem. So you're a businessman at that point. And you have to act like a businessman, not like a technology founder, right? So I mean, I think disagree with the presumption that you're a technologist. You have to think as a businessman. Because you're there to do business, you're there to make money for yourself and your company, and you're there to solve someone's problem who's going to part with hard-earned money to do that.
And by the way, the founders are the best salespeople for their products because they have conviction, they have passion, and they can talk about the roadmap that no one else who is not a founder would be able to do that.
Yeah.
So the best chances of you selling your product or your service or this thing is if you are the founder.
I have a quick experience to share, you know, adding to Nimish's comment, you know, to the point that somebody who feels like I can't work for anybody, I have to work for myself, right? Two things. First, you have to be your own worst boss. I mean, there can't be anybody who's tougher on you than yourself, right? Second thing, it's not just VCs. The first check I got from a friend after I struggled a lot, put a lot of my money, I received the check, I saw it, and I just walked into my room and like sat for a few minutes. My wife asked me, why are you not, you know, jumping? And you worked for this, right? And I'm like, oh crap, I mean, there's no going back now.
Yeah.
I mean, this is a big, I have to carry this now. I mean, there's no going back. There's only one way, all the way, right? So yeah, it's not just VCs, you know, with anybody, that's a factor. Now, a very quick survey, and I'd like all of you guys to please address this. Earlier, to Nimish's point, you know, stake. There is the founders, there is the, you know, core team, C-level team, and the broader team. And, you know, when you say, when it goes out and somebody from an outside looks at it, it shouldn't feel odd, right? For each of you, what feels like right among these four groups?
Can you define the groups again?
Yeah.
Talking about stake, right? How much stake do the founders keep? How much do they, set aside for core team to C-level and to the broader team? What seems healthy to you guys? First reaction, right?
Well, I mean, I think, again, it changes. Nimish and I are just investing in a company where they're two co-founders, three co-founders, actually. One of them has 60-70%. The other have 20%. And that you know, that was a sort of a red flag to me. So I talked to each one of them individually. And the person who had 20% had no problem with that.
Yeah.
He thought that this other guy, it was his idea, it was this thing, it was his vision. So he said, I'm okay with 20% and him having 60-70%. So if that's the situation, So fairness is really, is like beauty, right? It's in the eye of the beholder. But I think fundamentally people have to feel that it's fair. It's not, people don't mind inequality as much as they mind the fact that it's not fair.
Also, I think keep in mind that, you know, your notion of fairness is going to collide with VC's notion of what the right thing to do, which may not be fair, because they have a different metric. They want to disproportionately reward the CEO, and I think then the scale drops off very sharply after that. So the challenge that happens is you start with two or three founders, they own it equally. As you progress in the funding round, I think the VCs don't like equal division of equity between three founders when one is a CEO and other two are not. And they artificially start creating a division, and you have to be you have to manage that very, very carefully.
My name is Babu Krishna, from Nashville. I run a geospatial technology company, early stage company. My question is to do with leadership and as it relates to the expertise of a founder. If you don't have a co-founder, and you may have come from a technical background or a business background, so whichever one you came from, the other aspect you may generally lag in that area in terms of expertise. So in my case, I came from a software development background, and so the first thing I had to learn is how to sell, which I enjoy doing it, but you always have that skill gap between what you're really good at. My question is, there are two styles of management. You can hire a resource and completely trust them, be hands off, or you hire a resource and micromanage the hell out of them, right? It's pretty bad. If you know a subject, you end up doing micromanagement. If you don't know the subject, in case of sales and marketing, for most people, you're completely hands off. Now, which is, I know the right leadership is somewhere in between. From your experience, can you talk about how the leadership is evaluated based on the expertise of the founder?
So I have a third way, which is that I don't know that either one of those works, and I think that's what you were really implying, I suspect. That, you know, as if you start a company, and initially there's one or two of you, right? You basically get to do everything anyway, right? So whether you've ever sold in your life or not, you'll get to learn how to sell. You may not be very good at it, but you'll know how to sell. So all I want to do is know enough about in every subject area so that when I do hire the killer sales guy or the killer VP of engineering or whatever, right, I know enough to know if they're doing a good job or not. I don't need to know how to do the job. I just need to know enough to know if they're doing a good job or not. And if they're not, is a problem with the environment or is a problem with them? Right, that's all I need to know. And then I can focus on the third area that needs attention. Right, because obviously there's multiple things. There's, you know, if you're a product technical guy, you need a sales guy, then you hire a salesperson, then something else. Marketing might need attention. So my point is this, that as long as you have enough knowledge to know if the other guy is doing a good job, first of all, to hire a great guy, much, much better than you are, obviously. And then secondly, to be able to judge if they're doing a good job, and then that's enough, because then you'll know what the problem is. That's what I would do.
Well, thank you very much. You know, you guys have been great audience. Hopefully you learned something. We learned a lot from the questions.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.